Fish soup is on the menu. Mangrove swamps and crocodiles provide the scenery as gastronaut Keith Floyd continues his tour of Oz on BBC2 now. Here on One, more of the wonders we can expect to find in tomorrow's world.
Hi there, tonight we'll be showing you what's hot and what's not with the help of this and the band.
We are the robots.
Straight in the charts at number 27, Pop Pickers and Climbing are a group whose performance can best be described as mechanical. We'll be seeing more of them later.
Also, I'll be testing this, testing me. Could it really be a good way of choosing the right person for the job?
And we'll be finding out why cats love catnip. The answer could spell death for greenfly. But first...
Now, it's amazing what you can do with a temperature tester. Peter told me it'd be something near something hot. Definitely cold-blooded over there. There are a couple of cars over here. Well, the temperature's not going up there. Ah, but the exhaust there is a lot hotter. Gotcha, Peter.
All right, but that was far too easy a clue. And actually, I have to say, it was also something of a red herring, because although this machine is perfectly capable of measuring high temperatures like a hot exhaust pipe, it was actually designed for supermarket chill cabinets. Last month, the Food Safety Act made it an offence for shops to keep foods like soft cheeses or cooked chill meals at temperatures above 8 degrees Celsius, because at higher temperatures, bacteria like Salmonella and Listeria can breed. Normally, if a store was worried about, say, the temperature of a yoghurt here, they'd have to do this to it. Now, that's a probe in there that is giving us a temperature here of exactly naught. I hope it's working there. Well, there we go. But you wouldn't want to do that to too many of your yoghurts. With the new testers, you can actually stand back from the cabinet and simply point at whatever it is you want to measure. Now, we're getting a reading here of 4 degrees. There we go. Well below the 8. Like a thermographic camera, the tester works by measuring heat radiation. I will show up white hot on the image, and even cold food radiates. You'll see it as red. The tester detects the radiation, calculating the temperature of whatever it's pointed at. Incidentally, the red spot here is from a built-in laser, which just helps you aim at whatever it is you want to measure. Now, planted somewhere in this cabinet is some food that's been under the studio lights and then put back amongst the cold stuff. So I'm going to see if I can spot exactly where it is. We've got a built-in alarm on this thing as well, so if I do come across it, it should... there it is. It's somewhere back here. There. It's that yoghurt there registering 15 degrees. And if you looked at that on the thermographic image, you can see the yoghurt glowing white because it's hot. So that would be taken straight off the shelves, and the problem would be traced. So if you spot someone armed with this in your local supermarket, they're tracking down hot food in the cold store and keeping microorganisms and the law at bay.
Garden of England, and like many other gardens, it's plagued every year by something mean, green, and very hungry, the aphid.
Hops are as popular with aphids as they are with brewers. The hop aphid, Foradon humuli, has become resistant to most approved insecticides, making the future extremely grim for hop farming. So in this field, they're trying out an insecticide-free approach, and in the process, testing out that old adage that no one ever dies of love. Doesn't smell of anything to me, but to a male hop aphid, it should prove irresistible, because it's been laced with a love potion dubbed the scent of death, which has been developed through an understanding of the aphid's fascinating life cycle.
Most aphids don't need sex to reproduce. A female can give birth to copies of herself without help from males. But aphids that live in cool climates have to produce eggs, because only eggs can survive cold winters, and the only way to produce eggs is by having sex. That's a potential weakness.
In the late summer, female aphids lay both female and male offspring. The females then fly off to their favourite winter haunt, the plum tree. Here, they produce more females. The males, following on a few days later, mate with those females. Eggs are laid on the trees, and by next spring, a whole new batch of hungry aphids hatch out, ready to fly back and feed on the hop fields. So, how do the males find the females? Well, they do it by smell, because every female produces from her back legs a scent which attracts males. And scientists at the Rothamsted Nice Marling Research Station have, for the first time, managed to isolate the exact chemical which attracts the males, and they plan to use this to curb the aphid population. Female aphids release their scent in minute quantities, less than a billionth of a gram at any one time. But even those small amounts can be trapped and analysed by a gas chromatograph. And this is what you get. Each peak represents a different chemical, and somewhere amongst those hundreds of chemicals is one, or perhaps two, that will attract male aphids. And the best way of finding out which is the right one is to ask a male aphid. This one is having electrodes put into his antennae, which will detect his response when he gets excited. Catherine is going to release, one by one, the different chemicals that make up the female aphid scent until we get to the one that attracts male aphids. And that's the one. It seems that ingredient X is closely related to the chemical produced by this plant, called catnip, because of the effect it has on cats. They're very, very attracted to the scent.
Since it has the same effect on male aphids, the researchers are now using the catnip plant as the basis of their aphid attractant.
Back in the field, test trials have been going on all week, and the results have been very convincing. This dish is baited with essence of aphid, and it's attracted over 150 insects. This one, with plain water, has no aphids in it at all. Having proved that the artificial scent does work, the scientists are setting their aphid traps for the very first time today.
Males are attracted to the traps by their bright yellow colour. They're then lured into the top of the trap by the artificial female aphid smell. Once in this chamber, the aphids are exposed to a fungal infection. When a male aphid flies off and mates, he passes that infection on to the female. The fungus kills both aphids, and the result, hopefully, is less aphids next year.
If this works on a large scale, and farmers like it, very soon we could see on sale something very similar for insecticide-free aphid control in our gardens. And that's a prospect not to be sniffed at.
What general common name is given to the substances known as saccharides?
Sugars.
Correct. What is a medical term for a sensation of ringing in the ears?
Tinnitus.
Tinnitus is right. And at the end of that round, you have scored 13 points.
Well, just because you can answer a few questions doesn't necessarily mean that you're clever. What you need is a good memory. Mind you, mastermind champion on the old CV may help you in the job market, but to make sure you're made of the right stuff, employers now use a whole battery of tests.
The most established is the IQ test. It measures your ability to reason. And personality? Well, graphology, as it's called, claims it can tell a lot from the way you loop your G's and cross your T's. It hasn't done well in recent scientific trials, but its popularity shows what lengths employers will go to. There are more accurate ways of looking into personality, asking questions like, do you think things over before doing anything? Do you like to arrive at appointments in plenty of time? Not very subtle.
Now, what all these tests can't measure is how well a person performs when they're actually doing the job. But it's claimed that this equipment, developed by Dr. Paul Barrett at the Institute of Psychiatry, can do just that in 10 minutes, and it's impossible to cheat. Now, it works by flashing up two lines here of different lengths, and you have to judge which is the longest one. Now, we're going to start off nice and easy. Paul, half a second those lines will appear. Which one's the longest? Quite clearly the left one. Let's make it a bit tougher.
OK, we'll try one here at a quarter of a second.
OK, which one's up for the longest? Which one's the longest one? Ooh, I'd say the right.
Right, yeah? You're correct.
OK.
And we'll try one that's very difficult here now.
What's that?
This will be 10 milliseconds.
Ah! Now, don't worry. No one has been able to get it right at that speed. The idea is that the machine finds the minimum time the pattern needs to be up for the subject to consistently get the right answer. But Paul, can looking at flashing lights for about 10 minutes be as good as complicated tests over a number of days?
If you want someone who can perform several jobs at once, is confident of their own skills, and is capable of performing accurately for sustained periods of time, then yes, this can.
How did you develop this test?
As a byproduct of research in the early 70s on visual perception, they found that this task correlated with IQ. That is, the higher your IQ, the less time you need to see that difference.
Why is that?
We feel it's related to the biology of your nervous system and brain.
Now, doing a job well isn't just to do with intelligence, is it? How can this tell you how well people are going to perform?
When the going gets tough on this task, what we find is a great range of behaviours. Now, these behaviours range from people who can do the task very well, cool, calm, collected, maintaining accuracy of performance. Others simply fall to pieces on it.
Well, we did have our own guinea pig. Kate volunteered, and we can see a recording of her doing the test. What was her approach? How did she do?
We can see Kate doing it here. She was doing very well. It's fairly difficult now. She's concentrating hard. She's not really moving, which is good. I'd say she's pretty good on it.
All right, well, we'll find the result. Kate, how did it feel?
Well, it was hard work. But when it got onto the really fast ones, it just seemed to become a subconscious reaction. You either knew them or you didn't. Anyway, how did I do?
You did very well. You only needed 28 milliseconds to see that difference. With this equipment, you'd be classed as a high flyer.
Oh, how about that?
But what evidence is there that it does actually work?
Research in our lab has shown that this test is related to a more established tests of IQ and performance and personality. In addition, it's used as a recruitment tool by us, has saved us hours of time, money and effort. And we took it into a local government department and we're pleased with the results now.
Well, Howard, are you going to have a go then?
No, I don't think I need to.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Barrett.
Thank you.
Now for a little something that Judith ran across on a recent trip to Prague.
Jsi taky na kole? Tohle by tě mohlo zajímat. Podívej. Jsou tu dva kotouče, které se posouvají proti sobě. Jeden z nich je spojen s oběma půlkami talíře. Otáčej s nimi směrem k sobě a talíř se zvětší. Oválný tvar je velmi účinný, rozděluje energii rovnoměrněji než kulatý talíř. Na kole je páčka na řidítkách, když ji zmáčkneš, zachytne jeden z kotoučů. Když budeš šlapat dopředu, převod se zvýší. Když dozadu, sníží. Převod však není stanoven napevno, uvidíš sama, jaká změna převodu ti vyhovuje.
Děkuji, že menže se hezky. Ahoj!
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 I understood every word she said. Now, what could make personal television more personal, or even virtual reality more real? Well, perhaps this little piece of plastic. Last year, we showed you a video game which was the first practical application of virtual reality. To see the computer-generated world in 3D, you have to wear a helmet that has two liquid crystal television screens inside it. But one of the things that makes it less real is the quality of the picture. When your eyes are really close up to the screen, and I can simulate that by putting this little set here up against the lens of this special camera here, that is what you can see. You can see Judith's face there, but there are thousands and thousands of tiny dots, pixels, picture elements, and it's not that easy to watch. But if I put this thin strip of that plastic over the center of the screen there and then replace it, try and get it straight there, all of those dark lines have disappeared. Now, this plastic has lenses scored into it by a laser. They diffuse the light from the screen, which makes the separate pixels less obvious. Now, I can show you in a sort of way with this board here and a studio camera. If that camera defocuses, the dark frame lines disappear. But obviously, this plastic isn't just blurring the whole picture, or it would all look out of focus. There are almost 2 million lenses inside the plastic, which diffuse light in a controlled way. The light from each pixel passes through two layers of tiny lenses, which focuses it, so that the lines vanish without losing too much picture definition. And better picture quality could mean easier viewing in the future for a truly personal television set.
Aviation experts are today presenting their case for what they say is the most promising way to save lives in burning aircraft. Britain's Civil Aviation Authority has been studying a water spray system which was first shown on Tomorrow's World 4 years ago. Aircraft fires aren't common, but they can be devastating. It was the 1985 Manchester airport disaster which started intense debate over how to improve passengers' chances of escape from a blazing aircraft. The biggest problem in the accident was smoke and toxic fumes, so many experts suggested that smoke hoods would provide vital extra minutes during a major fire. But the Civil Aviation Authority rejected this idea last month, saying the hoods could confuse passengers and delay evacuation. However, they thought water sprays on board could offer a solution. In their tests, the CAA wanted to see how a fine water spray limits temperature during the first few minutes of a fire. Keeping the temperature down with a spray inside the cabin stops the fire spreading, so there's less smoke and fumes. Now, the white number 16 on top shows the temperature with the spray, and compare that with the temperature below in red from a previous test in an aircraft without the water spray. Well, if aircraft manufacturers don't find major faults with that idea, it's almost certain that within a few years, water sprays will become compulsory on new aircraft.
Yesterday, it was the CD, or compact disc. Today, it's the digital audio tape. Tomorrow, it's the mini CD. Can things get any smaller? Well, meet the cube. Potentially, a block the size of a sugar lump could hold hundreds of times more data than the old compact disc. The data is recorded using two laser beams. Inside the cubes are billions of ring-shaped molecules. These open up if they're hit simultaneously by both beams. Any information can be stored as a pattern of open and closed rings. To read it back, two new beams are shone in. These have no effect on the closed rings, but open rings give off a red fluorescent light when they get hit. At the moment, the cubes have to be kept in a fridge or they lose their data. But in about 10 years' time, this could be singing in the heart of your hi-fi.
Meanwhile, it's incredible what you can find under the seabed. The Channel Tunnel excavators have just unearthed a fossil which is 95 million years old. In those days, the climate in Britain was balmy, and these strange creatures lived in our tropical waters. This is its modern equivalent, the Nautilus, which now lives in the warm seas of the Caribbean and Australia. Well, this fella is the biggest fossil they've found so far in the Channel Tunnel, and it's now on its way for analysis at the Natural History Museum to see what else it might reveal about the English Channel 95 million years ago.
Mm-hmm. some people will get up to steal the silver. I've got away with it so far, but... and I didn't even touch it.
Kate, you're our high flyer yet again. Now, the silver's protected with an invisible electric field, and that's created by strips in here, metallized strips of tape under the table, and they're linked through a box of electronics to an alarm. The strips act as capacitors, charged metal surfaces which interact to create an electric field in the space between and around them.
If any object moves into that field, it adjusts the field just enough to be detected.
And you can see that on the oscilloscope. The voltage between the strips changes as Kate's hand gets nearer. As it reaches a certain level, shown by the line, it triggers the alarm. Now, we've certainly shown more sophisticated alarm systems, but this has lots of advantages. It's cheap, it's quick to set up, and it also can protect specific objects. You simply shape the tape, as we've done there. And then you have an invisible barrier that only includes the valuable objects you want to protect.
So I can't get away with the silver, but at least I can take one of these.
Norsk-Hydro were aware of the leaking mercury and were looking for ways to solve the problem. Despite this, their image as a responsible chemical manufacturer was damaged. So they commissioned and then made public a green audit, an independent report on their effect on the environment in Norway. The audit looked at all aspects of their manufacturing processes, industrial waste, air pollution, even local noise.
It was a big success in Norway. Even the environmental group that had broken in welcomed it, if somewhat cautiously. So their subsidiary company here in Britain decided to follow their lead and publish their own green audit. It was the first time in Britain that a company had published details of its environmental record and let the public judge for themselves.
That decision was taken by the UK managing director, John Spears.
John, going public with this report was quite a risk, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. I was worried about how the environmentalists might react, how other businessmen might react, and also internally for our management, who said, look, we're pretty good, but we're not perfect, so why tell everybody?
So why did you do it?
Well, in the first place, because I believe that the environment is an issue that is here to stay. The second thing is, Norsk-Hydro is not very well known. I saw this as good PR. And the third reason is that I don't think that businessmen are involved enough in the debate. It's us who are going to deliver the goods, so I want to get more involved in it.
So what does the report actually say? Well, in places the PR does show through and it reads a little bit like an advert, but on the whole, their environmental performance seems quite good. You get the feeling that they're chipping away at the problem bit by bit.
Some things are almost common sense. This is Hydro's PVC plant near Darlington. After the plastic is made, this sludge remains as waste, but there's still some PVC suspended in it, so it's left to settle out in these tanks before the rest is discharged. This way, they recover 500 tons of PVC from their waste each year. And to save energy, they've also just installed a heat exchanger, using waste heat produced when the PVC is made to help dry the finished product. These measures are easy, though. They're good for the environment, but they're good for business, too, and they were already being done. Perhaps Hydro only published their report because they knew they had a good story to tell. Their performance was better than the law demanded, and they were also pretty sure the public wouldn't pressure them into improvements which would then make them uncompetitive. That worry has held a lot of companies back. But now that Hydro have shown that going public needn't hurt, other companies are under pressure to follow their lead. They won't all look as good as Hydro did, and there may be pitfalls, even for the cleanest. It turns out that today's good record could conceal tomorrow's problems, because green audits can go a lot further. Hydro are starting to look closely at the environmental standards of their suppliers, and also at how to recycle PVC on a large scale. The aim is not just to check that the factory's clean, but to look at the product itself throughout its life, from production to disposal, from raw materials right through to the rubbish tip.
The EC is pushing hard for companies to do these cradle-to-grave audits and publish them. And if companies choose to make that sort of information public, they could be heading for quite a shock, because for the first time, the public will know exactly how much toxic cadmium, say, or mercury, is being discharged from factories right around Britain in total. And some of those figures could be worrying. They could even force the government to tighten their pollution controls. And for some industries, that could hurt.
At first, companies may see a public green audit as good PR, but it brings with it new responsibilities too, so the environment should benefit. What remains to be seen is whether industry will show itself in its true colours, green or not.
Meet Kraftwerk, or at least their robot doubles. The track, not surprisingly called The Robots, has just entered our pop charts. The German musicians that make up Kraftwerk are well known for their robotic style of performance, so it seemed a natural progression to have robot lookalikes. The robots will be performing live as part of the band's tour this summer. Kraftwerk have always been a technically innovative band. In the early 70s, they were among the first to use synthesizers and rhythm sequencers, often building their own before they became commercially available. And the latest project is to build the robots. When this track's performed, the robots will become Kraftwerk and the humans will leave the stage. The same computer that generates the music then also controls the movements of the robots. Well, that's it for tonight. See you next week when we'll be drawing out the winners of our Out of the World competition. Space Age prizes include a trip to tour the universe from Toronto or witness a total eclipse of the sun from Hawaii. See you then. Good night.
Automatic, and we are dancing mechanic.